Welcome to the online training for the Wisconsin Bumblebee Brigade, a statewide, citizen-based monitoring project. This training is divided into multiple parts, all of which are available through this YouTube playlist. This video provides an introduction to the Bumblebee Brigade survey methods. There are three basic steps to participating in the Bumblebee Brigade. The first is to survey for bumblebees and take photographs to document what you see. The second is to curate your photos. You could potentially take hundreds of photos during a survey, but you shouldn't submit all of them to the project. Instead, you will need to select and edit the best photos for submission. The final step is to submit your data online. If we do not receive your data, it cannot be used for research and conservation. This is a completely photography-based project. That means there is no netting, touching, or handling of bumblebees at all. Photographs are required to document your observation. DNR staff and partners will look at your photos and verify the identity of the bees that you observed, which cannot be done without photos. You can volunteer to observe bumblebees almost anywhere. You should focus your search on areas with blooming plants. You are unlikely to find many bumblebees in areas with nothing in bloom, like the middle of a parking lot or a turf grass field. Bumblebees emerge in April and May and can be seen through October. Avoid volunteering while it is raining, during high winds, or in severe weather, both for your own safety and because you are unlikely to see any bees. Bumblebees are slower and easier to photograph when it is cool, so try to avoid the hottest parts of the day during the summer. There are two ways to contribute to the project. The first is by making incidental observations. These are the most basic form of observation and only require photographs and some simple information about where and when the bee was seen. These can be casual or unplanned, for instance, if you see a bumblebee while gardening. They can also be a great way for beginner volunteers to develop their skill set before moving on to more complex observations. The second way to contribute is through small area surveys. In a small area survey, you purposely look for, photograph, count, and record the bumblebees that you see at a single location following the project guidelines. Both incidental observations and small area surveys provide valuable information, but small area surveys provide more data, and the data from small area surveys are needed to meet some of the project objectives, such as tracking the size of bumblebee populations over time. As mentioned before, both types of observations require photo vouchers, meaning the photos of the bees that you submit online, and both can be conducted either alone or in a small group. However, we encourage pairs or small groups for small area surveys, rather than working alone, if at all possible. In this video, we will focus on how to conduct small area surveys, as they require specific steps that incidental observations do not. When conducting a small area survey, you will need to record some basic information, such as the date and your location. For a small area survey, you will select a 30-meter in diameter circle in which you will count and identify all the bees that you see. You do not need to photograph every single bee that you see, but you will need to photograph at least one bee of each morph. A morph is a visually distinct type of bumblebee. We'll talk more about morphs in a moment. As you count and photograph, you will record your data on the data sheet. When you are done surveying, you will need to curate your photos in order to finalize your identifications and select which photos to submit. You may choose to use the summary sheet to organize your data before submitting. The final step is to submit your data online to the Bumblebee Brigade website. Let's explore each step in more detail. The first step in conducting a small area survey is to select where you will survey. The Bumblebee Brigade asks you to record your location in two ways. The site is the general location or area in which you are surveying. For example, this could be a state park, your property, or a nature center property. The only requirements for choosing this general location are that you are able to access it legally and that there are flowers in bloom. Within a site, you will select a survey location. This is the specific 30-meter in diameter circle that you will monitor that day. So if your site is a large state park, your survey location is the precise area in the park that you are monitoring. For instance, it could be the flower patch next to the west parking lot or a spot on the northwest side of the park by Trailhead 135. In the diagram on the screen, the site is the 100 meter long rectangle and the survey location is the small circle towards the left-hand side. At a very small site, like your own backyard, there might not be a significant difference between the site and the survey location. However, in most spots, there will be many possible places for your survey location. When choosing a survey location within a site, please select a spot that seems likely to have the highest number of bumblebees while also being accessible for you to survey. One point to keep in mind is that you do not need to return to the same site multiple times throughout the monitoring season, but you are welcome to do so. If you are at a large site, such as a big county or state park, you might want to conduct multiple small area surveys within a day. You are welcome to do so as long as the edges of the 30 meter in diameter circles are at least 100 meters apart, as seen in the diagram on the upper left. In some cases, you might find that your small area circle is slightly obstructed. For instance, your circle might overlap with a road. In urban settings, especially in backyards and gardens, structures like fences or garages might jut into your survey area, as seen in the diagram on the bottom right. That is okay. Do your best to place your circle in an area with as few such obstructions as possible, and then survey all of the accessible area. Within your 30 meter in diameter circle, you will need to count and record the number of individuals of each bumblebee morph seen. A morph is a visually distinct group that you can tell apart in the field. Morphs can be distinguished by color patterns, the number of abdominal segments, males have 7, females have 6, the presence of a corbicula or pollen basket on the legs, indicating that it is a female, or size in some cases. In the image shown here, all of the four bees are of the same species, but they each have a different color pattern, and there are different numbers of abdominal segments. Each bee image represents a different morph, and if you saw them in the field, you would keep a tally of how many of each morph you saw. Sometimes you will be able to immediately identify the morph you see, for instance, a male common eastern bumblebee, Bombus impatiens, or a female rusty-patched bumblebee, Bombus affinis. Other times, your morphs will remain unidentified until you can closely examine your photos. That is fine, and you will gain more skill with identification over time. Note that the Bumblebee Brigade Field Guide, available on the Bumblebee Brigade website, has some of our most common morphs, but bumblebees are highly variable, so not all are shown. There are several ways to delineate your 30 meter in diameter circle. We recommend standing in the center of the survey location you have chosen and establishing what falls within 15 meters in all directions. Because the circle is 30 meters in diameter, the radius, meaning the distance from the center to the edge, is always 15 meters. You can measure 15 meters with a measuring tape, with a piece of rope or string you have pre-measured at home, or with your own stride if you are on fairly level ground and have previously measured and tested your own stride length. Once you know what ground falls into your small area survey circle, you should check all the flowering plants within that circle for bumblebees. Don't forget to check flowers that grow low to the ground, like clover or dandelions, as well as tall flowering shrubs and trees. As discussed on the previous slide, tally each bee that you see according to its morph. Take photos of each morph you see. It's a good idea to take many photos to ensure that you have some good shots. We recommend taking a spacer photo every time you switch to photographing a new bee. Take a picture of your notebook, your hand, or the sky between bees as a spacer photo, so that when you look through your photos, you will immediately know which photos are of the same individual bee. Do your best to avoid double counting bees. Try to keep track of the general direction that bees are flying in, so that as you move around your survey area, you will have a sense of if you are looking at the same or different bees. This can be difficult when you are just getting started, but as you gain more experience, this will become easier, especially as you are able to hone in on small differences in individual bees, such as if they are carrying pollen or what the condition of their wings and hair is. Don't get too stressed about missing a bee here and there or occasionally double counting. Just do your best. And remember to only record bees within the 30-meter diameter circle. If you see a bee of note outside of your circle, you can add that as an incidental observation. When you are conducting a small area survey, you can use the small area survey data sheet available on the website to keep track of your observations. At the top of the data sheet is space to record the required basic survey information, such as the location, name of the surveyors, date and time, and habitat. The data sheet has two ways of collecting data on bumblebees seen. On the first page, you can write or sketch a description of each morph you see and put tallies next to the description for each individual you see. There is also space to record the photo names or numbers that you take for each morph. This is important to do because it might be difficult to remember which photos go with which description and tally counts hours, days, or even weeks later when you are looking through your photos. On the second page, there are small graphics of the most common male and female morphs of Wisconsin's 20 bumblebees. If you see a bee that matches these morphs, you can simply place a tally under that picture. This page also provides space to record your photo names or numbers. In some cases, you might use a combination of page 1 and page 2 to record your sightings. For instance, you might find that most of the bees you see match the morph shown on the sheet, but one does not. If that happens, you would tally the one bee on the first page and write or draw a description of it, and you would tally everything else on page 2. Just be sure to only tally each bee one time. Note that at the bottom of the first page, there is a spot to record if you have seen a nest. We are very interested in bumblebee nests and their locations, so be sure to record it if you find one. Once you have completed your small area survey, you will have a lot of photos. If you saw a lot of bumblebees, you might even have hundreds. So the next step in the monitoring process is to curate your photos. To do that, the first step is to identify the morphs in each of your images. You need to determine the species and sex of each morph that you tallied. For sex, we ask you to differentiate between queens, females that may be either workers or queens, and males. We will cover bumblebee identification later in the training. After you have identified all your morphs, select the photos you will submit to the Bumblebee Brigade website. These should be the photos that provide the most identification information. Ideally, we want to see a photo of the head, dorsal or backside, and side views of each type of bee. Once you have done that, crop and center the selected images so that your bee is prominently visible in the photo, preferably in the center, although we know that might not always be possible. Please be sure that the file size is less than 1 megabyte. After cropping, that is usually not a problem. You may choose to use the summary data sheet to organize your observations prior to submitting online. The summary data sheet gives you an easy way to combine all the initial data you collected into a simple, straightforward format. It provides a box for the number of queens, females that are either workers or queens, males, and nests that you saw for each species, along with the photos that you plan to submit. The summary sheet is especially useful if you saw many different types of bumblebees during your survey, or if you recorded several different morphs that ended up being the same species and sex. For instance, Bombus rufus cinctus, the red-belted bumblebee, has 20 or more possible color morphs. If you saw males of three of those color morphs during a survey and tallied each of them separately, you would need to combine that count into one single tally for rufus cinctus males before submitting your data. If you conduct a small area survey and don't see any bumblebees, we still need you to submit your results. The absence of bees is just as important as the presence of bees. For instance, imagine that in the map shown here, the blue stars represent surveys where bumblebees were reported. If that is all the data we have, and if people only report the surveys that had bumblebees present, we would know that they are found in the southwest corner of the state, but we would have no data on the rest of the state. Bumblebees could be there, or they could be completely absent from the rest of Wisconsin. But if volunteers submit null data, meaning survey results with no bumblebees found, we now have much more information. In this example, if the yellow circles indicate surveys where no bees were found, we would have good evidence that bumblebees are found in the southwest corner of the state, but not throughout the rest of Wisconsin. Happily, this is a hypothetical example, and we know that bumblebees are fairly widespread throughout the state, but receiving null data or surveys with no bumblebees tells us where and when they were not present. So please be sure to submit your small area surveys with no bumblebees found. Regardless of whether you saw bumblebees or your survey came up empty, the final step in the monitoring process is to submit your data to the Bumblebee Brigade to support bumblebee monitoring and conservation, and to have your bee identifications verified. We will discuss data submission later in the training. This concludes the monitoring portion of the training. If you are new to the project, please be sure to watch all the training videos.